my husband Walter, who does, he's a fine artist, blah, blah. So we have nothing to say. Anybody ask any questions?
That's right. We do comics. We're like fish out of water at a cosplay show, but it's actually it's fun. We're having a great time watching all the costumes walk by. We think those are awesome. Are your ears actually moving? Awesome. That's awesome. I've seen that. I saw somebody, not here, somewhere else, when I had ears in a costume, and they began moving, and I flipped out, and thought it was fantastic. I think it's great. So very cool costumes. I think that's great. But it's a pretty, it's quiet for us, which is just fine.
So how do you want us to arrange this? Do you want us to just let you guys ask questions, and then we know that you were saying something that you were interested in?
I mean, we can tell you what we're doing first if you want.
Yeah.
Well, what are you working on now? What are your current things?
Because you we're doing to start with.
All right. At this point, I'm mostly doing books. So, you know, but back in the olden days, I did more comics. Although I am doing a series of educational comics for a group that's doing teaching math skills to really little kids, like, you know, 5 and 6 and 7 year olds. And I love doing it because I feel like I'm harnessing the power for good. I spent enough years having characters beat each other to death, ripping off characters' wings, and
which I still do.
Yes,
we keep it in the family.
So I actually kind of feel like, you know, it's time to do some good with what I do. My little halo is glowing, so that's really what I'm doing now.
What are the names of those books for the math for little kids? I have 4 year olds.
Okay, they're books. I don't even know what the name of the books are exactly. The first one, I only saw a computer proof of the first one so far. It's some characters called Yumiko, U-M-I-G-O. And I think that if you go onto the Yumiko website, you can see like video games and stuff, math video games, math stuff. I'm betting your 4 year old will be about right for these. The idea is that they're presenting like these math concepts to children that are disadvantaged, so that, you know, we do know a two and a half year old who pretty much already knows like the names of, you know, triangles and pentagrams and, you know, just the different parallelograms and all of that stuff, which is, you know, one of the ideas that we're introducing, you know, in these comics. So it would be children, I guess, whose families, you know, aren't thrusting math concepts at them very early.
Yeah.
So, I bet your 4 year old probably already knows this stuff, but it might have fun anyway. They have activities in the back where, you know, you use shapes, volume, shapes and volume and stuff, little experiments and things kids can do.
Very simple.
Yes, and I love doing it. So there.
It's needed.
Is it? Are you a teacher?
I teach fourth grade right
now.
Yay! I've taught K-1, 2, 3. And it is. It's a wonderful service you're doing because there's so many things that children don't grow up in rich environments with background knowledge, maybe. And so that's a good way to hook them and get them to see those concepts.
And comics are such good teaching tools because you've got like little discrete bits of, dialogue and information. And you've got pictures that you can look at that will explain visually what the words are saying. So if you've got a visual learner, or you've got or even an auditory learner, because some of the, they're also doing little songs that go along with the videos and the comics. So, you know, I'm loving doing it. Anyway, so that's what I'm doing. I'm also doing a series of like Superman books for young readers. I can read type books. I'm just starting on that, so, you know, we'll see how that goes. Which should be fun. Yes.
Okay, what was it like working on the Death and Return of Superman story arc, which, by the way, I think is one of the greatest Superman story arcs in existence?
I agree with you. That was wonderful. that was one of the best things I've ever worked on. It was a great experience, and it's kind of different than doing an ordinary series of comic books. And that, you know, I don't know if you knew how the Superman books were done. I'll explain that first of all. The Superman books back in the day when I did them were all interconnected. There were 4 and then 5 Superman books. And they were all, each book was a chapter. And every chapter chapters would come out once a week. So that, you know, I would get, you know, part, whatever, of an arc of stories. Usually the arcs would be Sometimes it would be two or three issues, sometimes it would be four or five, or a really long one like The Death of Superman. We would have all of us who worked on the comic, this is the editor, the assistant editor, all of the writers, all of the artists, all of the pencilers, all of the inkers, even the colorists, not the letterers, oddly enough, would get together at this big meeting. Mike Carlin, who was our editor and our, at first, the first editor of the Death of Superman stuff, was a wonderful editor for this. It took somebody who was really coordinated. He had great assistants. Big chart on the wall. Okay, and we would all bring in our ideas, and there were plenty of ideas because, you know, there were a lot of people involved, and you know, we're all in creative fields. And you'd say, okay, this issue of Man of Steel, what would we want to do? Blah, blah, blah. And we'd create a character arc, and we would write in roughly what would happen in each issue in a very large fashion, like, I don't know, Superman, Doomsday kills Superman, you know, whatever. And so that we would have a certain amount of flexibility within the context of the overall story arc. We would know what had to happen, but how it happened was up to each of the different teams. So, and it was really, it was a fun way to work. It took me a little while to get used to that, because I was used to working the Marvel at Marvel, where I had been doing X Factor. And, you know, each issue, as I would try to structure it, would be a complete story, but would be part of an arc. So you would have a beginning and a middle and end, and you would pay off on what the story was within the context of that act of your arc, I guess. And the Superman stuff, each of us tried to do that as well, you know, within the context of a larger arc. But then, of course, we had to pay attention to what came before and what came after. What that meant was that we couldn't, everybody had to kind of keep on schedule. The writers did, the artists were, it was a little more flexible for them. But the writers had to get everything, you had to read what the other guy had done, play off of what they'd done, then do what you wanted to do, and get to the end of your story so the next guy could do the same thing for his book. So that was kind of, I mean, that was, you know, down in the pits, what it was like. I don't know if that answers your question. Did you have anything more specific than that?
It was actually a great boon for FedEx because they would Xerox all the art, reduce Xeroxes of all the issues, all the art, and all the scripts, and everybody got copies of all that stuff to keep them up to date on what was being done by everybody else. So we were very friendly with our FedEx guy for some time.
That was back in the day before everybody scanned everything and put it on, his PDFs on the
computer. I mean, that just wasn't, the web, the way it is now, wasn't available for that kind of information sharing at that time. So we actually, for about 2 years, we had a separate line in the house for a fax machine. We had so many faxes coming in and out that we just couldn't, tried to have one line with a machine that would distinguish. Things got too confusing. Oh no, wait, that's a real call. Somebody else is. So we had a real line for about 2 or 3 years. And then eventually when we began scanning stuff, then it became really obvious that the fax machine was just, gathering dust until we got rid of the extra line. But that all that started to be coordinated at the office. That was stuff that Mike and his assistants all did. They did a phenomenal job to make sure he was up to speed all the time.
I mean, specifically with the death of Superman, we had not originally meant to kill him, which I think is probably, fairly well known. We had been working toward, a wedding kind of thing way back in the day, maybe. And we came up with an entire story arc. The publisher came in and said, "Oh, you can't do that. We have a." They never bothered to tell us. The writers are always the last to know, just so you guys, in case you ever want to be a writer, that's like rule one for being a writer. The writer's always the last to know. You can't do that. We've got a TV show coming up. And Lois and Clark are not married in this. They're just...
Was that The Adventures of Lois and Clark?
Yes, back in the day.
Terry Hatcher.
So you're going to have to do it all over again. You're going to have to do it fast because it's about time for the conference to be over. So we said, Jerry Ordway, who always said, "Let's kill him," said, "Let's kill him." And this time we were pissed off. And we said, "Yeah, we're gonna kill him." So we did. We came up with a, that was pretty easy. I mean, you know, who was going to, who could possibly kill Superman? We came up with the idea of Doomsday. We had a contest among the artists, a 5-minute contest in which everybody drew what they thought Doomsday would look like. Dan Jurgens won that one. So
looked great.
He looked great. Great design. And so you know, okay, this is what our villain looks like. And you know, it all progressed from there. You know, it was like, you know, we wanted to do a countdown. We would do it with, you know, 4 panels on the page, and 3 panels on the page in the next issue, 2 panels on the page in the next issue, and the actual death would be one panel per page, just because it was fun. We decided to do, you know, doom, as Doomsday earlier, you know, setting up the arc earlier where Doomsday would be breaking out of his containment vessel. And that was, so then we did it, and it was hugely successful. I mean, all of us have killed characters before. You know, we've done terrible things to our characters. And, you know, some people shrug and pay attention and some don't. I mean, you know, we did get some flack for ripping off Rachel's wings, if I remember right.
Well, they're back.
They're back. They got better. but it turned out to be immensely successful. I mean, we knew Death sold because, you know, that was one of the things you learn early and back in the day anyway. I guess it's still true.
And also you learn, you know, common characters get better.
They get better.
They get killed, then they get better.
And we're not gonna permanently kill a character that's gonna kill our great writing Superman gig, you know.
Well, look, we all have mortgages. We have kids.
That's right.
We're not gonna, and as if you could destroy Superman and Time Warner, who owns him, would say, oh, they killed him, I guess we're done.
Yeah, right.
Like that would happen. So
I guess, okay, and after that, so the Death of Superman comes out. And Superman's dead, and then we go to, I guess there was a cocktail party, wasn't there? If I'm remembering, this is a story
I've heard. This is the story we got.
It may or may not be true. This is the apocryphal story that it sounds like, was that there was a cocktail party. The publisher, the Death of Superman just came out.
No, it was that Fumetti that was in the, Fumetti that came out?
It was a Fumetti.
That was in Us Magazine or one of
those. There was also
things.
An ad with an Energizer batteries last as long as Superman.
They had a big full-page color ad in print magazine with Superman breaking his chains in one of the famous pictures, and it said Energizer batteries last as long as Superman. The day that ad came out, the news broke that Superman was dying.
and the publisher was like, you can't do that. And the
Jeanette,
it was fine. It was fine with Jeanette. It wasn't fine.
But there was a party
with
this.
I don't know what the deal was with that.
But I think the CEO of Time Warner or somebody that was very high
that
up
was
in the
it.
Chain that was way beyond where the comic books were, and I'm sure he never talked to guys doing comics. Period. And he was at a party, I think, and the story was that somebody came up to him and said, "What's this I hear about Superman being
right.
killed?" I beg your pardon. So then it kind of hit the fan.
And they tried to quash it. I mean, it got all this media, because nobody had, like, blown up anything or done anything terrible in the news. So all of a sudden, you know, we were getting all this media coverage, which was a big shock. Never happens, except for every once in a while.
Well, also, in the comic books, you know, honestly, you do kill characters off and on dramatically. They do get better for the most part. And Superman certainly get better. And so, you know, at the comic book level of participation, none of people doing this, I was just watching Weezy do it, but none of us would think in a heartbeat, this is going to become a newsworthy story, you're going to freak out. I've got Jeff Darrow, who's a wonderful artist and writer, does some neat stuff, a lot of movie designs, like The Matrix. Jeff lived in France a lot. He was over in France, he was in a cab, and the cab driver discovered he was an American, and began screaming at him, "How could Americans kill Superman? How could they get him?" And Jeff's like, "Look, I got nothing to do with this." So, I mean, it's you kind of forget that people outside the industry would have a different view of what we do. So, in a way, what you want to do is you want to do the best job you can killing him. But you also know down the road, you want to pay off in some way with however you're going to reconstruct stuff. Mm. That make it work again. You need to do your best job doing that, but you know, always think about that. And it just never occurred to anybody that this is going to become, you know, obviously that was a day when bombs hadn't gone off somewhere.
Yeah, it was a slow news day.
I was watching Tom Brooke on NBC that night, and all of a sudden the last news story of that day was Superman dies. And they showed a pinup by Todd McFarlane of Superman that I had had Todd do for a Superman story I had done. And I got some friends of mine to do pinups. As it happened, Tom was one of them, and his pinup got used as the little picture above Tom's shoulder as they talked about Superman croaking.
There you go. So, but we didn't know how. I mean, we knew we would bring him back. Carlin did set it up so that after he was dead, we did cancel the book for, I don't remember how long it was, a few months, three issues, something like that. I don't remember. And then we had to have a big meeting about how we were going to bring him back and what was going to happen. But
and there were a whole series of books for Rock called World Without Superman, where four, each of the four writers, the four teams of creators, created their own version of a Superman-powered kind of guy, not Kal-El, but somebody else. In one case, I think Dan did a cyborg.
Yeah, we had a cyborg. We had
you
Superboy,
did Steel.
I did Steel, and
Eradicator,
of course.
So they were all these different, you know. And so that ran for a while. That ran for maybe a year.
Yeah,
something like that.
Yeah, it was a while.
So, you know, you never were not going to bring him back because the licensing is too big for one. You know, these characters like Superman have a life that's completely outside the comics. And sometimes you can accommodate that. Sometimes you have to kind of eat some stuff and not do things you might do otherwise.
So, did that answer your question?
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay. Does anybody else?
How much does that work in media?
The internet wasn't what it was now. Now you would get.
We did do signings and stuff.
Well, also, what did happen?
If they wanted to come after us, they could have.
Yeah. It didn't. But what did happen was that Time Warner, more or less, this will be recorded, but I'm not
trying to write that
up here. They tried to quash it. They couldn't not. The book was already out by the time the news got the food chain news was happening. So the book was already in print. So the word essentially came down, we don't want any media coverage of this. If anybody gets a hold of DC, which they did, you say nothing.
Uh-oh,
you
yeah.
said we have no comment. We want this to go away. And then you discovered that they got more PR out of it than anything that happened since the first Christopher Reeve movie in 78. And this was in 92 or thereabouts. So suddenly it became a big commercial enterprise. And that became a whole, then suddenly the word came out, oh yeah, sure, Tom. Yeah, no problem. Yeah, well, you get questions, yeah, sure, no problem.
Yeah.
So, but as far as the kind of hate mail that you would, or hate stuff that you would get on the web now, that kind of thing and that kind of volume you get because of the access to the web, and because I think myself the anonymity of the web, that wasn't true. I'm sure there were people who were cranky about it, but not in the way that you would get now.
Yeah, you have to deal with it.
No.
There were actually a lot of people who seemed to think that Superman was really gone forever. And I felt kind of, you know, they would buy up all these copies of the book. And we did have to sign a non-disclosure agreement that made us not able to talk about what would happen next. So that we couldn't say, look, don't believe everything you read. And, you know, it was like, mostly civilians, people who weren't used to comic books, actually really buying into it and thinking they were going to, you know, buy up, you know, 15 copies of The Death of Superman and their kids in college with it. It was like, no, don't do this. But, you know, I think it was actually a pretty good series. So, and it was enjoyable. So we really did the best we could in it. So, you know, I don't feel bad about that, but I do feel bad about anybody who bought a zillion copies thinking they were going to put their kids through college because there were so many of them out there.
You know, back then,
no rare collecting.
You know, if you bought 15 copies, you spent $30.
Yeah.
It isn't like you spent $1,000 on crack.
Yeah.
You know,
I guess whatever. It's like buying a lottery ticket. It's $1
so,
a dream.
Yeah, it's $1 a dream. So your dream's over.
So, any other questions?
Yes. I have one. I'm just starting out
I'm trying to get my comic out into the public so people can read it. I want to publish. I wonder how did you guys get started? Did you publish? Did you self-publish? Or
it was a completely different world back in the day.
Yep.
I mean, there were two or three avenues into working in comics. One of which was to work, get a job actually at the company in some capacity, and if people liked you, they'd give you a chance to write stuff or do whatever you did. Do you want to get in as a writer or artist or both?
Both, actually.
Okay. Well, the writing avenue was the way I did it was I was working in advertising promotion in New York City for a publisher, McFadden Martell, and I had a friend who worked at one of the comic book companies, Warren Publishing, which was a black and white independent publisher, essentially. We did horror comics and a monster magazine. And she said, well, there's an opening at my company and it pays better than your job here, so why don't you come apply for it? And I said, sure. I'd read the Warren comics and, I liked them. The Blazing Combat was a wonderful war comic. So I said, yeah, sure. I'll do that. And I went in and I got the job acting in the, production. Thank you, honey. My brain went away. In production, doing like paste ups and mechanicals.
Back when none of those computers didn't really exist at this time, we're talking about.
Right. I mean,
they were room sized Univex. That's how this is all
going. Right. And you'd write ad copy and it would go off to some printer and come back in a block and then you'd paste it down in a piece of paper. Strange world, huh? And
rubber cement.
So I got a job doing that, but since it was a small company, which are the best to work for, in my opinion, particularly when you're just starting out, is that they always needed hands to do stuff. So, if they needed somebody to write, I was not actually hired to write ad copy in the beginning, but, they said, well, gosh, can anybody do this? And I'd always say, I could do that. Whether I had ever done it before or not, it looked like it was pretty easy. So I would do it, and, I could do it, whatever they wanted. And then in letters pages, I could do it letters pages, do this, do that. So eventually they just created an assistant editor position for me to do that. When the editor left, and they were looking to hire an editor for the line, I went in and kind of demanded the position.
Because they were looking
outside for an editor. And I said, well, I can do that. And Jim Warren said, oh, girls can't edit horror comics.
This is the old days. We were out of
okay.
It was
now,
just funny. It's
now,
like,
honestly, Jim also would have said anything that he thought would push your button.
He was very good at it.
Yes, which he obviously pushed my button because I said, look. I said, I'll do the comics for 6 months. I'll do it on my assistant editor's salary without an assistant. I'll get everything on schedule, and I'll make it sell better than ever. And
at the end of that time, if I've done that, I want the job,
oh, yeah.
I want the title, and I want the money.
Yeah, so I did that. So he said, what is he not stupid, right? He's going to get an editor for free.
Oh, my God.
So he said,
cheap for 6 months,
well,
no matter how
long. Well, the editor job, I'm just getting my assistant editor.
Well, that's why they're cheap, but much cheaper.
Yeah, oh, no kidding. So I did. And he did, and eventually he made me a vice president. So I was a very good official title.
I mean, with the way Jim talked, I wouldn't have taken the girls' can of horror comic, especially seriously. He's just very good. The other thing that Weezy didn't say, which I will say, because this is the kind of stuff that actually happens, and it's individual, but it's kind of everybody's story in a way. When is it? Back in those days, the story was that Jim Warren, that the Warren Company made its money not on the comics, but if you bought a Warren comic, an Eerie or Creepy or Vampirella, in the back of the comic, there are pages and pages of catalog stuff. It's all these grids. It's a grid pattern of all the pages, a product shot, and a little blurb about the product and the price. And he had all that. He had the Captain Company, it was called. And you look through it and went, oh, wow, I would love to have a monster mask of the Creature of the Black Lagoon for $15, a rubber mask. You write, you would send your money, and you'd get it. So the story was, I don't know if it's true, the story was, what he was really doing was selling a catalog he made money out of by putting comics in the front. Now he ran, it was mostly comics.
I mean, the comics were profitable, but I think a lot of his profit came from
the from the Captain Company. But it was profitable, but that's what that was. Well, in those grids, it's a product shot, there's a little block of copy. The block may be four lines.
The most fabulous latex mask ever made, based on the original designs, or whatever.
And Jim was cranky. We've already established that. And in this little box where you had the, you'll understand this, you had the words. If you didn't write it properly, you would get blah 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 blah.
And there'd be white space.
It'd be called a widow. This little, you'd have one or two words at the bottom and some white space. Jim wasn't paying for white space. That was a box.
He wanted a word
everywhere. I want a word everywhere in that box. And back in those days, printers, this is where you typeset, before computers, you could fudge the length of lines somewhat, not infinitely, but by lengthening out the spacing between the lettering, the letting between the lines, spacing lines had to be the same all the way across, would look the same. But you could space the lines, you could space words, you could, you know, between words, you could fudge some. So essentially what they called that was, that box had to be written to character count. In other words, you had to have X number of characters, plus or minus whatever it was, to fit so that you could do the stuff you could do to make that box full. In order to do that, you had to write to character count, which meant you had to write, you know, grammatically correct English with the right number of words or characters.
And imparting information.
And impart the information. And it turned out that Wheezy was brilliant at that. When she offered to write the ad copy, that's what she had to do. She had to write it so that, so that was one of the reasons she got moved to editorial.
Because he wanted the letters pages also written to character count.
So
because he wasn't paying for white space. So.
And then she got moved to editorial because she could write to character count. And then she began editing stories, helping build a bed, helping them in that stuff, and again, well, other things as well. But I love the idea that that was one of the major.
It was an important. You never know I guess the moral of the story is you never know what's going to turn out to be an important life skill. You know.
Yeah.
But it worked out well.
So that's her. And then I got moved over to Marvel. Essentially, I could see that Warren was losing interest in the comics. I think he was moving more into real estate or something like that. And I had been getting offers from Jeanette Kahn at DC to come over and work there. I did for a couple of years, and I kept turning her down because I kind of liked having my own little fiefdom in which I could run.
And Warren, you were the queen.
I could run experiments on my readers to see what they liked and what they didn't like. It was really fun. And but eventually, I could see that, you know, the Warren stuff was beginning to tail off. And when I got an offer from Marvel, I took it and went over there and started working at Marvel first as an editor and then as a writer. So I mean, that I don't know. Honestly, it would be one way of getting in. It was working for a company, but I don't know how close you are to any companies. I mean, I was in New York, so I could do it. But and there are now comic book companies all over the place. I know that.
I mean, it's also true that the business model for comics now is quite different. Was when we broke it in 72, and Wheezy got her job at Warren in 74.
And you came to New York deliberately wanting to do comics.
I did.
Whereas I just wanted into New York thinking publishing was where I wanted to be. You know, I wasn't particularly picky about what kind of publishing.
So in my case, I was a geology major in college. My interest was in studying paleontology and dinosaurs. I graduated in 68 with a degree in geology. And at the end of my senior year, I decided that paleo was not what I wanted to do. I'd applied to grad schools, but I hadn't heard back from them yet. But I reached the point where I said, you know, I can see that I like dinosaurs, I still do. It's not what I want to be doing. Whatever. And I didn't know at the time what I wanted to do. The only other interest I had really was drawing. My dad was a scientist. Friends were all scientists. Family friends were. Nobody I knew was a freelance artist. Nobody didn't have a job. For the job, but not in the same way. They were all, you know, worked at universities or worked for the government. Mostly government universities, not so much private industry. Mostly folks my dad knew were public servants one way or another. And so he couldn't help me on that score. So I wrapped it up without any real idea where I was going. I graduated in 68. That was, 68 or 69 was the biggest year for the call-up of young men in the draft for Vietnam. I was drafted. I flunked my physical. Boy, it was not the worst day of my life. I'm really, really, really nearsighted. And so they said, you know, thanks a lot. We can't give you a gun and put you in the jungle with glasses. We're just not doing that. I said, well, you know, darn. So, And it was a very tough time to be 21 years old. I mean, I had friends who went to NAM. I had friends who didn't come back from NAM. I had friends who went to Canada. I had friends who did, you know, medical deferments or went to med school and got deferments. I mean, I had the whole lot. I'm very relaxed about what anybody did back then. It was an awful time to be young. And it was a tough time in the country. So, but I got that solved. That I hadn't made any long-range plans at that point because I didn't know what my plans were going to be. Well, I got drafted at the end of the summer, took my physical, flunked it, and then I had the rest of my life to live. I knew it wasn't geology and it wasn't the Army. So I applied to art school because it was the only thing I really, other interest I had. I had not liked art classes. Back in junior high school, I had art classes. I hadn't liked it. I mean, how young are you in junior high school? You think that's going to guide your entire life? But of course, things do. All I wanted to do was draw. In art school classes, my art classes mostly, it was like, okay, this week it's paper mache sculptures. This week it's toothpick constructions. This week it's something. Just give me a pencil, let me draw. That's all. So I got like B's in art mostly because I didn't want to do the rest of that stuff. But I love drafting. I took drafting for a couple of years. I love drafting. I love the discipline. That's where I first learned to use ink because I had a high school drafting teacher who taught us to ink our drawings. So I began using ink more as a medium and then applied to art school after I got out of college. I got accepted as a transfer student, even though I graduated, at the Rhode Island School of Design in Providence. I went in there as a sophomore, was there for 3 years. During my first college career, besides all the other stuff I was doing, I discovered Marvel Comics. Because they were coming, it's like 65, when Stan and Jack and Ditko and those guys were really doing, I think, some of the best work of their careers right then. So by the time I left my original college, I had a collection of comic books I'd bought, and I knew all the continuity back about 4 years, maybe five. I didn't, listen, Fantastic Four number one, there's no kids here. It was fucking $7. I wasn't gonna pay fucking $7 for a damn comic book. Well, I kinda wish I had a different thought back then. I kinda wish I'd been smarter at the time, but I wasn't smart enough to see that. But that's okay. I back collected a work comic for about $1.50 and went, that's enough for a comic book. I'd read that stuff. By the time I was in art school, I'd kind of quit reading Marvels because by the late 60s, they were kind of repeating their stories. By that time, Galactus was coming around hungry for the third time, or The Thing was a bad guy for the second time because the wizard had gotten whatever. And, I said, well, I kind of read these. But by then, DC was doing some really strange Enemy Ace, which was just none of them ran that long. They were fantastic comics. Enemy Ace was fantastic. But Hawk and the Dove and Angel and the Ape, they tried a lot of things. Didn't go very well, but they were very interesting. So I read that stuff. They did the Edgar S. Burroughs material. Joe Kubert did Tarzan, my favorite Tarzan artist of all time. I love John Buscema, love Hal Foster. All the guys are all great. There's a quality about Joe's that was just raw, that felt like Tarzan. And he drew beautiful animals. It was just fantastic. So I was really into comics by the time I was at RISD. And I eventually began doing comics there for class projects. And I had teachers that allowed it. Ultimately, my senior thesis, essentially my degree project, was a 50-page comic that I wrote, penciled, lettered, inked, and bound. The second half, first half wasn't worth binding. I bought the second half. I did it over 2 years over my junior and senior year. It was my senior thesis. Nobody that I know of to that point at RISD had done a comic as a thesis. Within 2 or 3 years, other guys were doing them, but it hadn't been done. Nobody there knew comics well. My major professor actually had been offered a job out of RISD. He was a RISD grad himself. He'd been offered a job with Al Capp when he got out of school for cartooning, and he thought about it, and he thought, well, if I work for Al Capp, the best I'm going to be is a really good Al Capp lookalike. I'd rather kind of be myself. I'd rather be a really good Tom Segura's, even if Tom Segura's isn't as good or as well known as Al Capp. And so he didn't do it, but he knew comics, he understood what I was trying to do, he knew what was going on. So I was very lucky, I was able to do that stuff, and what it gave me was and by that time, the only Marvel in DC were putting out the kind of comics I wanted to do. I mean, there was like Richie Rich back then, and Casper the Friendly Ghost, and the Duck stuff, the Walt Disney stories. There were a lot of funny animal comics, they were neat. I'm a giant Carl Barks fan. Maybe my favorite guy ever to do comics, so I'm with funny animals. But what do I want to draw? So And back then, no computers, no faxes, no FedEx, none of that stuff, no internet. So if you wanted to do comics like DC and Marvel produced, you lived in New York or right around New York because you had to go to the office. Now, if you were a John Buscema or a John Severin, you could live somewhere else, well established, and you could mail your stuff in. Back then, they had some special handling on packages. It would get there in like two or three days. So that's what you did. But if you were starting out, that wasn't what you did. You didn't do that from a distance. So I moved to New York. I lived in Brooklyn. Met a bunch of guys doing comics. Went to DC. The short form is that I, through a series of incredibly lucky happenstances, I ended up in the editor-in-chief's office with my portfolio, which he liked. And he had the company give me work. He called in three editors. You've saved our lives.
Thank you. Thank you.
And he made the company, he called in three editors, and they each gave me, had to give me a short, a backup story. Now, there aren't backup stories now, really. So again, it's a very different business model, different time. All of us young guys at the time did backup stories. That's where you cut your teeth. That's where you honed your craft. You know, you got paid. My initial page rate was, I think, $40 or $45 a page for pencils and inks. I kind of lived on it, or out in Brooklyn somewhere. I'm not quite sure how that worked, but that was, you know, it was worth more money then than it was worth now, but it still wasn't a huge amount of money. And, you know, in backup stories, you could do bad work and people didn't see it much and you learned your craft and you know, stuff like that. So that's where I broke in. 6 months later, I'd been working for Archie Goodwin, who was an editor of DC Comics. I'd done some science fiction stuff for Archie. I don't know if this would apply now or not. At that time, science fiction was kind of a ghetto for comics. There were some, you know, Space Cappy and then Three Adventures. I don't remember what the name was in the series, which I kind of liked. Adam Strange, you know, The Adventure of Adam Strange and Strange, what was it, Strange Adventures, I think. But it wasn't very big. It wasn't a big area of comics. There were a lot of other, back then there were more varieties of comics in the mainstream than there are now. Now it's mostly superheroes. You know, the romance books still, and they were all kind of dying out. They're still around. But I learned very rapidly that if you got typed as a science fiction artist, that's all you got to offer. And I could see why it's not going to be a real career if that happened. So I worked very hard, and eventually, after a few months, I got a job a friend of mine wrote for Archie. That was a story about the Alamo. It was three pages long. Some really terrible drawing. Some of the drawing's not terrible. It's a mix. But I read an entire book on the Alamo. I didn't write the script, but I wanted to know more about it, so I read it. I did a lot of work. I did a downshot at the end of the entire Alamo, the compound, with the four columns of Mexicans coming in from the side on the last day at dawn when they came in with sounding the trumpet that said, no quarter, we're going to kill everybody. And so I learned a lot about it at the time. Well, not long after that, I was offered, Archie was going to do a backup story for a comic called, Detective Comics, called Manhunter. And he asked me if I would write and draw, or I would draw it. And so he wrote it, I drew it. It was a bi-monthly, eight pages. By then I was probably getting $50 a page. What is that? 50 times eight is $400. $400 every 2 months. I probably had a few other jobs here and there, just some oddball stuff.
Back in the day, you'd get an apartment in New York for $100.
My rent was $120 a month back then in Brooklyn.
Now it's sometimes that.
It's a lot more now, even in Brooklyn.
For that.
No, you can't. Right? For a day you can park, maybe 2 days. That strip did very well. There wasn't, again, did very well professionally. There wasn't the kind of organized fandom that there is now. There were fanzines. There was fandom. There were some comic conventions, early ones, 72-73. There weren't very many. There were a few here and there, one in Washington, D.C., probably one up here in New York. But mostly, there wasn't much feedback from fans the way there is now, and fans didn't make or break books. It wasn't that kind of an industry. But what did happen was, it ran for a year. I did seven chapters. Archie wrote them. We won six awards from an organization that's not around anymore called ACPA, the Academy of Comic Book Arts. We won six Shazam awards. We had seven stories. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
And by the time it was done, I was established in the industry. When I started that strip a year earlier, well, my friends knew who I was, and my, you know, Chaykin and Weiss and
Wrightson and Kaluta, the guys I met and became friends. They all knew who I was anyway. But by the time that strip was done, editors knew who I was. So I didn't have to look back to get work. But mostly what you needed in comics was you had to have the work and you had to have a break. And everybody kind of has that story. One, well, my break was getting into Carmine Infantino's office and having him like my work. It reminded him of the work of a guy named Bernie Krigstein, who did some brilliant, brilliant work. I did not know Krigstein's work at the time. Looking back, I'm incredibly flattered that Carmine even thought of me in the same sentence. But it's the kind of thing that it worked out for me. Wheezy was able to write to character count and then do some other stuff as well.
Actually, what I was told later was that I looked like the editor that when I went into to apply for the job, apparently I looked like the editor's first wife, whom I guess he was still friendly with or liked the way she looked, because apparently that was why I was hired.
It wasn't a bad thing.
Nobody ever said that while I was there, and I mean, he never hit on me or anything, but that's what I was told, which I thought was, you know, that's just luck. That's where luck comes in, if that's indeed true.
Well, and the thing with Carmine, I mean, showing the editor-in-chief my work, or the public, whatever Carmine was, that publisher, I was told a million years later, like maybe 5 years ago, like 35 years after I got the job, that one of the things that Carmine liked about my work, he had been an artist, he was one of the rare artists who became an editor. That didn't happen very often. And he'd been a very good artist, but he'd kind of gotten out of it for a long time. Got back to adventure, but gotten out of it a long time. And what I was told by a very good friend of his was that Carmine saw in my work not what he thought he would have become if he'd stayed as an artist, but the beginning of what he might have become. One of the things he liked about my work was it in some way reminded him of his own stuff or what it might have been if he'd stayed in comics. So, you know, these are factors you can't, I mean, you just do what you do. At the time, that's how you broke it. If you were a writer, we used to tell people, there were three things. You get a job at the company, they're in the mailroom, mm-hmm. just so you can meet people, and that's just networking. Right. You network, you meet people, you know, you learn them, you become friends, you're not a putz, you know, you get that kind of stuff. Two,
you can get famous doing
something
else.
Become Stephen King. If Stephen King gets old Marvel and says, I'd like to write a Spider-Man story, I will bet you any amount of money, I'll bet you all the money I'm ever going to earn the rest of my life, and all the money I've earned in the past, they're not going to say no.
And that's still, I mean, that still holds.
And that would still be true. If you become famous as some other writer, you're going to be fine. And there was one other one, too. Somebody was as goofy as that. Be an artist.
Right, be an artist.
Because there are fewer slots for writers than there are for artists.
Right.
So,
because a writer can write more books than an artist can.
And it's also, it's harder to get an editor to look at your work. Mm. The thing is, the editor, if he looks at a writer, he has to read it. I mean, I don't mean that facetiously. You have to sit down and actually put in some time reading it to see what the writer's got. Whereas an artist, 10 seconds into a portfolio, you know if you're looking at work that's gonna be, now you don't always know if it's gonna develop into something that's not good enough, but you can look at art and you can be really clear about it really fast. So if you're an artist, that's how I got into writing. I did it as an artist, and after 7 years, I ended up doing writing because that's what I was able to do it.
This video is sponsored by the Crazy Kings of Toys. Check them out for all your toy needs and find out why they are so crazy. Find them on eBay, BrickLink, and Facebook. Links are in the description. For more Toxic Pop, visit our website at toxicpop1.wixsite.com/toxicpop. Email us at toxicpop1@gmail.com and check us out on Facebook at facebook.com/toxicpop1 and Instagram at instagram.com/wearetoxicpop. Links are in the description.